Good morning, everybody. Come on in, grab our seats. All right, everybody getting ready for Christmas? I'll let you know one of my pet peeves is the Xmas. I hate that. I don't know about you guys. I've even not gone in a store, you know, if that's what they have on their sign. So our first song kind of emphasizes that, you know, it's not Xmas, it's Christmas. So if everybody would go ahead and stand, we'll start our worship today.
What?
rolls out. It's that red book in the backside there. So. We're going to sing the first Noel. We're going to do the first two verses and the last two verses. So we don't have the words on the screen, so you got to get your hymnals out there. Page 91.
Father, I thank you so much for this day. I give you praise for each one that were able to come this morning and just worship you. Lord, I pray that you will open each heart and let us receive your word, Lord. I pray that that we would understand what you have for us this morning and that we would carry that with us throughout our week. Lord, help us to remember this season, the birth of Christ and what that means to us. We thank you and we praise your name. Amen.
Amen. Have a seat.
Good morning, everybody. It's so nice to see a full house. Does anybody want to share their testimony? Anything that happened this week? Their life. They want to share.
We just want to thank everybody for your prayers. We were out sick. We had bronchitis. We did have COVID tests. They were negative, but we did have bronchitis. We're back. We've gone for about 3 weeks, whether you missed us or not. But Genevieve's doing real well. I'm doing well, and we're just thankful for all your prayers, and thank you. And thank God for all that he's done for us. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
Anybody else want to share?
So this is the third Sunday of Advent, and we really learned a lot this week in studying this. Advent is all about preparing our hearts for the coming of Jesus Christ, both when he came as a child and for the second coming of Jesus Christ, and making room in our hearts and bowing in humble submission to God. And this week's Advent is about joy. And joy can be tough sometimes. It can really be tough because joy is not a feeling. It is not happiness. It is knowing the goodness of God and knowing that you are assured your place in heaven because of Jesus, because of what he has done for you. And what better reason to rejoice and have joy than Jesus?
And today's scripture, I have two scriptures. The first one is Matthew 2, 10 and 11. When they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceedingly great joy. And when they were come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary, his mother, and fell down and worshiped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented unto him gifts, gold and frankincense and myrrh. And the second scripture I have for you today is Luke 2, 8 through 14. And there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone around about them, and they were so afraid. And when the angel said to them, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all the people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you, yea, that you find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of heavenly hosts praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill towards men."
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, I just want to thank you. I just want to give you all glory and honor to you. I thank you for sending your Son Jesus to us that we might have life, that we might have it abundantly. And I thank you, Holy Spirit, for coming and being with us each and every day, that we can focus on what we need to do. And we thank you for this Christmas season, that we can give you all glory and honor. And help us not to be distracted by the hustle and bustle of this season, but help us to keep our eyes focused on you, Jesus, because you are our light. You are our joy, for you are the joy of, you are the strength from the joy that you give us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Mary, did you know that your baby boy would someday walk on water?
Mary, did you know that your baby boy would save our sons and daughters?
Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? This child that you delivered will soon deliver you.
Mary, did you know that your baby boy would smile like a blind man?
Mary, did you your baby boy would calm the storm with his hand?
Did you know that your baby boy has walked where angels joy? When you've kissed your little baby, you've kissed the face of God.
Don't they do good? You should tell them they do good because it makes them more confident. But don't say it too much because then it makes their like head swell up a little. So, of course, they do great and they deserve some press for that. Well, we got some birthdays this morning, so let's go ahead and I got to rearrange the whole stage here all by myself. All right, there you go. There you go. One of them being my old man. So happy birthday, Dad, tomorrow. He'll be, I don't know, how old are you going to be? 29, perfect. So, yeah, with a 37-year-old son, that's interesting. Yeah, so. I'm not great at math. I know that don't work out. all right, and the other one being Maxine Forrest. You know, she today's her birthday. So on your way home from church, swing in and say hi to them and just love on them a little bit. One of the reasons we haven't seen him in a while is just kind of with Art's condition in his back. He's got some sciatic issues and just can't sit for a long period of time. So swing in and say hi to him, and they appreciate any time you spend with him. Rana Shimmons, where is she? There she is. She's going to have a birthday Tuesday, so we're celebrating her. We're actually having a whole party just for her at our house tonight. Also Christmas, but for Rana too. And then Trent and Jory's birthday is coming. Is Trent here with us this morning? Isaac has a feeling that someone in his family has a birthday, but... Oh, they won't be here next week. I think Angie should come up too. So come on up if it's your birthday. Rana, Ken, and Angie, come on up. We'd love to pray over you this morning and ask God to bless you. And if you want to pray for these folks, why don't you come on up as well? We lay hands on and pray over them and ask God to bless them this coming year. And
pushes in.
All right. Well, would you join us as we go to the Lord in a word of prayer? We are thankful, our Father, for the opportunity to come into your presence, to speak to you, to have our petitions heard, but most of all, Lord, just to be near you. I do pray that as we draw near, that we would feel your presence here in real, tangible ways with the senses that you gave us. That we would hear your voice. That we would that we'd see you with our own eyes. That we would that we'd be able to feel you clear nearby with our own hands. And Lord, we are just thankful for the opportunity to come before a holy God, being broken and sinful the way we are. We thank you for the sacrifice that Christ made that possible for us to enter into your presence. And I do pray this morning as we bring before you Maxine Forrest. What a wonderful woman you created in her, and a woman that our young ladies can look up to and desire to be like. And she goes forward in such a great example of love and patience and endurance under trial. Lord, what a wonderful person she is, and we thank you for all that you've done in her. I pray that this next year be a blessing to her, that they be healthy, that they be able to stand up under the difficulties that life brings their way, that, Lord, you would just give them strength and peace during a time like this. And we also want to lift up my dad, Ken, and thank you for him, for the man that you've created him to be. We just pray that you would continue to bless his life, give him success in everything his hands touch, his work and in his hobbies and in his family and in grandparenting and all the things that, Lord, he finds himself doing, that you would give him success in all those things, and that he would be like David, that everything he touches would prosper. And Daniel, Lord, the great men from Scripture. And I pray that this year would be the greatest year of spiritual growth that he ever experienced, that he would know you more deeply, that he'd see you more clearly, that he'd be able to walk with you more closely than he ever has, and that this next year would be the best year that he's ever had in his life. And we thank you in advance for what you're doing in his life. And I also want to lift up to you Rana Shimmons, Lord, a young lady with a fantastic disposition and spirit about her. And Lord, she's so quiet and gentle and kind. And we are so blessed to have Rana around us. And I pray that you would continue to build her up, continue to shield her from the hazards that come along with living in a world that is seeking to destroy our young women. And I pray that she would be shielded from that and she'd be protected from that and wouldn't have to worry about all the problems that accompany being an adolescent in this age. Lord, that you would let her studies be easy, that she would learn well, that she'd be disciplined in her work there, but most of all, that she'd have a deeper relationship with you this coming year, that she would preach the gospel to herself, preach it to her father, preach it to her mother, and preach it to her friends, not through her words, but through her actions, and that we would see the gospel lived out in Rana this coming year, make it the best year of her life. And we pray for Trent and Yuri as well, a young man with great mechanical skills, like his brain just works that way. We thank you for it. I pray that you would continue to build him up in his family. Let him be a leader, even though he's the youngest, and let him lead his family well, walking towards you, and let them be inspired by his example. Lord, we pray that once again, he's living, growing up in a world that's seeking to destroy him, and we pray for his safety and his health and his mental health and his spiritual health and all the spaces that our young people are attacked. I also want to lift up to you Angie Apel, a lady that if she was not here, our church would struggle more than anything else. And we would really have a hard time if it wasn't for Angie. So we thank you so much for her, for the sacrifices she makes, for the work that she puts forth, and all the things that she does for us here at Grace that makes this place work. And we thank you for the family that you've brought with her and that you've created in her, and the joy that we get from all of their children, from Josh. Lord, what a wonderful group of people they are, and we are thankful for them. I pray that you would continue to build her up, continue to keep her eyes on you, that even as she's doing work around the church, that she would see that as an act of worship to you and not as just her job. And we thank you so much for the spirit that you've created in her and the heart to seek you that you put in there as well. I pray that you would bless her this coming year, give them rest here on this vacation they're about to take, and give them the ability to really, truly connect to you even when life is busy. We love you, Jesus, and thank you for all you do for us. As we move forward in this service, we are thanking you as well, worshiping you in spirit and in truth, knowing that you are here among us and that you are leading and guiding every word that is spoken and every step that's taken. We love you, Jesus. Thank you for everything. In your name we pray. Amen. All right, so our littles are free to head to their spaces. So head on out. $128 this morning. good morning. How's everyone doing? As I was thinking this morning about the joys of life and different things that we take joy in, I kind of thought through this, like, when I was a single man, like, the happiest I could be would be a 10, the saddest would be like a negative 10, like, that's the scale, if you wanted to give it a scale, you know what I'm saying? Does that make sense? Yeah. And then I got married, and some of you are thinking, like, oh, and the scale shrunk. No, it got bigger, actually. Like, I'd say the happiest you could be is like a 20, and then the saddest, like it infinite. Like, if something bad happened to my wife, I was more sad than if it happened to me. But if she was, like, really excited, I was more excited, you know what I'm talking about, than if it happened to me. And then I thought, like, this is the happiest, like, this is the greatest wealth of happiness I could ever have. And then, or joy that I could ever have. And then you have kids, and the boundaries disappear. Right? Like, if they're excited about something, you're more excited than you, there's not even a number you can put on it. And if they're, like, broken, there's, like, you are sad beyond measure. You know what I'm talking about? Does that make sense? Does that expand somehow with grandkids? I don't know. I'm not there. Right? Yeah. You know, that you kind of watch those things disappear with life, that as you kind of step into those roles where you are, and honestly, those roles are very sacrificial roles, which was another thing I thought was interesting, that within sacrifice became increased joy, and I thought that was kind of an interesting thing as I kind of thought through that and prayed through that concept of, like, the more that I put myself in a subservient or sacrificial role for somebody else, the more my joy increased. Anyway, just kind of some of the things I thought about, but one other concept that I can considered this week as I thought through and prayed through this concept of joy was the difference between joy and happiness. And happiness is probably one of the weakest things that we can experience here on this earth. It is extremely fragile. And I quit saying this for a while because every time I said it, something bad happened. And I'm not, you know, to quote the great philosopher Michael Scott, I'm not superstitious, but I'm a little stitious, right? Does that, you know the Office? Anyone? Anyone with me on that? All right, so if you don't, shame on you. You should watch that. Anyway, your phone could ring in your pocket right now, and your happiness would be gone. And it doesn't matter how happy you are. Your phone could ring in your pocket right now and steal that, right? Isn't that true? You could get a call from a family member. You could get a call about your job. You could get a, like, right now, your happiness could be gone just by your phone ringing. And speaking of which, could you please silence your phone so you don't steal my happiness and have it ring in the middle of service? But happiness is weak. It's fleeting. It does not endure under the afflictions of life. Happiness cannot stand when life gets difficult. It doesn't have the strength that joy has. And a lot of people think that they're the same, but they're not, right? Happiness and joy are not the same. They're very different. And what's funny is, in a lot of ways, we cannot define the difference, but we know it when we see it, right? You know what I'm saying? So here's an example. If something tragic happens to someone and they're happy, we think they're crazy, right? But if something tragic happens to someone and they're still joyful, we find that inspiring. What's the difference, right? How do we define the difference? We don't know, but what we do know, we can tell it when we see it, right? I can't put it into words, but I can tell when I see it. And there's significant differences between the two. And just the recognition that they are different, I think, and just being able to recognize that shows that the two are, and they look the same. Right? There will be a smile. There will be there will be a positive attitude. There will be a good outlook on life. Right? These people have very similar things between happiness and joy, but they're very different. Joy is strong, and it can uphold against the cares of this world when happiness cannot. Now, I had this discussion with several people this week. I had this discussion with Charles this week, and he's not even here to revel in the fact that he's now been, you know, cited in a sermon. But anyways, Lisa talked about it with Lisa this week, and just Nolan this morning, that can an unbeliever experience joy if joy is a fruit of the Spirit? And so we kind of talked through this concept of happiness versus joy, and can an unbeliever experience joy if joy is rooted in the Spirit of God? But one thing we discussed, and all three of us as we discussed this, or all four of us as we talked through this, came to this realization that, and I believe this is correct, so help me out if I'm wrong, but pat me on the back if I'm right. Because this is the thing, right? Everyone tells you when you're wrong, but no one's like, hey, good job when you were right. Anyway. Speaking of pet peeves, Josh, that's one of mine. Yeah. What is your joy rooted in? Because that's what matters, right? Because, like, let's say your joy is rooted in your family. What happens when something bad happens to your family? What happens when one of your family member passes away? Is your joy gone? Because that's what it was founded on. That's what it was rooted in. And what happens if your joy is in your job and you get fired or you get laid off? What happens if your joy is rooted in some kind of special skill or something that you worked really hard to be good at, and then all of a sudden you have an accident and you can't do that anymore, right? Your joy has been taken from you. Because it's not that they can't experience joy, it's that their joy is not in the right thing, right? They're finding joy in something other than God himself. Because if our joy is found in Jesus Christ, it cannot be taken from us. It's just like faith. Unbelievers have faith, just not in the right thing. And they're putting their faith in things other than God himself, and it can be taken from them. So joy is much like faith in that it can be experienced, but it won't be experienced in its fullness until it's put in the right thing. And until we're putting our faith in Christ alone, we will not have the joy that he wants to bring us. And he is the one eternal giver of joy. And there's another piece of this that I think is important, because if our joy is in circumstance, that will change, and it can change very quickly. So our joy is much more like happiness than joy, because it doesn't have the strength that it should have, because it's not rooted in the right things. It's like building a house on the wrong foundation. It might be a beautiful house, and it might be just as beautiful as a house on a good foundation, but it won't stand when life comes against it. So speaking of the joy and really finding the fullness of joy, let's begin in the book of Job, because we know how joyful that book is. And I want to show you kind of biblically what I'm talking about. Because I can theorize all I desire about the Lord and about joy and about how he's working these things out, but if I'm not rooting my theory back to Scripture in something real, then it's just conjecture on my part, right? I want to root everything I believe about God back to Scripture. Amen? You don't believe that? Is that not true? Right? Let's root everything we believe about God back to Scripture. So Job chapter 20, verses 4 through 7. If you don't have a Bible with you, there's a hardback black one in front of you. You're also welcome to use a device if you so desire. That's kind of your bent. If you don't own a Bible, keep the black one. It's a gift. Also, there's leather ones if you want that instead. All right. Job chapter 20, verse 4. Do you not know this from of old, since man was placed on earth, that the exalting of the wicked is short, and the joy of the godless but for a moment? Though his height mount up to the heavens and his head reach to the clouds, he will perish forever like his own dung. Those who have seen him will say, where is he? Now I read that, and at first I read that and I'm like, come on, Job, we're in church. What are you talking about dung about? Right? But then I'm kind of glad that he's coarse like that, because he's showing us a reality that the joy of those who do not find it in Christ is weak, and it will perish, and it's as worthless as his own dung. Amen? That our joy is not rooted in Christ, it is without purpose, it is worthless. Now, the joy of the unbeliever may be joy, but it's fleeting. Have you ever met a person that's just miserable? If you haven't, it might be you, so maybe you want to look in the mirror on that one, right? But you know what I'm talking about? Like, they are just an absolutely miserable human being to be around. Like, when you see them coming, you're like, how can I get out of this, right? And I've done this. There's a person that I run into sometimes when I go to the gym, which isn't always off that often, but sometimes when I go, I run into this person, and now I've gotten to where I look for their car in the parking lot, and if I see it, I'll come back later, right? I'm just a miserable person to be around, right? And sometimes you're like, how can someone be this insufferable? Like, there's so much poison in them that if they bit themselves, they die, right? You know what I'm talking about? You know, like, everyone's smiling like, yep. I'm going to see them at Christmas. They come to my house every year, you know, right? Maybe they're in your family. I don't know. Maybe you married into that and you're like, if I had known, I would not have married you. I love you. But did I go too far on that one? Too far? Okay. Anyway, get an elder check on that. Brian, did I go too far on that? A little bit? Yeah. Okay. Sorry. Maybe I shouldn't have said that. And sometimes it seems like the only joy they get in life is by taking yours. Isn't that the truth? And I know that these people exist, but what I'm talking about is people who have a joyful disposition, but their joy isn't in Christ. Their joy is in something else in the world. And you know that if life comes hard enough against them, that joy will be taken. The joy of the godless is a fleeting experience. Because true and lasting joy is found in Christ alone. And as we dig into this idea of joy, I want to not only show you that real and lasting joy is possible. Because I think living through the last couple years has shown us that that joy can very easily be taken even from a believer, right? That I watched as a lot of people, in a lot of ways, fell away from faith because of the trials of the last couple years. And listen, the last couple years weren't that bad. It didn't take much to knock them out, did it? Right? I mean, in reality, we look back the last couple years, what happened? We had to do a few things over video call, and we ran out of toilet paper. In reality, that was kind of the worst of it, right? And gas is expensive. Good night, is it expensive, right? When I started driving, I think gas was $1.25 a gallon. Anyone here can beat that? I know some of you can. Yeah, who we got? What we got? 26 cents. Anyone got 26 cents? No? No one got 26 cents? Yeah? And you probably complained then, like, why are they charging so much for this, right? Yeah, that's your fault then. Okay, now we know it's Art's fault. Blame him. All right, but what I want to show you is that not only is joy possible and accessible to us, it's a command from God. And before you get fired up and upset that God is commanding this of you, and he's so demanding, and why is he like this? Understand that you're angry because he's commanding you to be joyful. Like, and don't let yourself go down that road of like, God's so demanding. Yeah, he's demanding that you be filled with joy. Thank him for that, right? How miserable do you have to be angry that he wants you to be joyful, right? Like, he wants me to be happy. I'm not doing it, right? But joy, being a fruit of the Spirit, is not just a command from God, but it is something that he will work to produce in you. And that God himself will fight for you to be joyful. And so it's not a burden for you to carry, it's something for you to rejoice and watch as God produces it in you. Does that make sense? That as we connect and we live inside of this presence of God and his Spirit is within us, he will produce that in us. And he'll work to carry that burden alongside of you. And because that's a thing we hear a lot of times, right? That God won't put a burden on you too heavy for you to carry. That is garbage. He will put burdens on you all the time too heavy for you to carry, right? Raise kids, that's a burden too heavy for you. Get married. There is not a sanctifier on this planet that will make you more Christ-like than marriage will, right? If you want to see the spots in your life that are rough and are not godly, get married. They'll point it out, right? Why are you looking at me like that? Every time... No, but you point it out, right? I'm that bad, and you point it out, right? if Amy and I are going to fight, it's going to be about this. This isn't in my notes, so just buckle up, everyone. We are in dangerous space. So if we're going to fight, this is what it's going to be about. I'm in the midst of hard battle with one of our toddlers, right? Where I am seeking to, like, bend them into the will of God. And I'm working hard in the midst of this. And she disagrees with how I'm doing that. And she jumps me at that moment, right? That's our fight, right? Pretty much nothing else. That's our moment. Where she comes at me. I'm like, I don't need a mom either. Like, I don't need a mom right now. I'm trying to follow this kid. You're not my mom. Back up. You know? Like, real conversations we have in front of our children who are like, we won. Right? But that's our moment, right? It's in that, and we've talked about it later where it's like, hey, if I don't disagree with what you said, jump me after, right? Let's wait until the moment's passed. And then, so it's not about that she said something wrong, it's that it was the wrong moment. Does that make sense? So find the right timing. Anyway, that's for free. It's not even in my notes. You all know that we're fighting. If you see us having a discussion, just wait. All right, so, all right. But if the joy in our lives is a product of the Spirit of God and there's no joy in your life, I have to ask if the Spirit is within you. I have to ask if the Spirit is alive in your life, if he's welcome to speak, if he has the space to do the work that he's to do. Because he will, it's a fruit of the Spirit. He will produce this if he's there, right? And then the last thing I want us to see is that God fights for our joy. So Hebrews 12 is where we're going to kind of anchor ourselves today. So if you want to flip over to Hebrews chapter 12, and we'll get started there in verse 1. 948 to the page if you're using the black Bibles. Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and sin which clings so closely, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the founder and the perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. So as we talk about this idea of joy, we would be remiss if we did not talk about suffering. Because if you have not suffered in your life, I need you to understand it's coming for you. There will be a moment where you will experience deep pain. There will be sleepless nights. There will be anxiety. There will be worry. There will be brokenness. This life will not leave you without marks. Does that make sense? You following that? That this life will beat you up. And as we talked about last week, that is because of the word of God that's seeking to take root in your heart. That afflictions are coming. And what makes a person of Christ different than someone of this world is that when hard times do come, you still have joy because your joy is founded in Christ. And we are looking on to something greater than the circumstances of this life to hold us up. And the pain of this life is nothing in comparison to the joy that's coming. And we look at Christ as our example, as the one who endured the cross, knowing that what was to come was far better. and he was looking forward. Like, I don't think Jesus was on the cross filled with joy, right? He was in a moment of intense pain and suffering. He's being tortured, and his life is being drained out of him. He wasn't filled with joy, but he had joy in knowing that it was coming, right? He could look forward to the future and see the hope that was to come. And one of the great lies of our age is that when you come to Christ, your life will be easy, right? And this is a lie that Satan weaves into people's hearts. And and you've heard it called the prosperity gospel. Have you heard that? That if you just get saved, God will give you a Mercedes and hide $600,000 in the walls of your house, right? Only a few people got that one. Yeah. 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 I want to tell a story, but I don't have time. Okay, so anyway. That we think that somehow we'll be on easy street if we come to Christ. And then what happens is a person says, yeah, I'll give my life over to Christ. And then things get hard. And they decide, well, maybe this Jesus thing doesn't work. And Satan has weaved his lie inside of that. Because I can honestly tell you that God is not that concerned about what you drive or how big your bank account is. Right? That without faith, it is impossible to please God, right? All he cares about, does he have your heart? And in the midst of life's difficulties and hurts and pains, we can still have joy knowing that better times are coming and that God is carrying this burden with us and that we aren't walking through it alone. Another great lie of Satan, you're going through it alone. But we have a God who promised, I'll never leave you or forsake you. But why is it so much easier to trust the lies of Satan than the truth of God's word? And so, in the terrible moments when life hurts, when things are difficult, when we can't see joy ahead, we can trust not that better days are coming, but we can trust the God who promised that better days are coming. Right? Because my hope isn't in a better circumstance. My hope is in the one who holds tomorrow, right? And my joy is found in him as well. Look at verse 3. Consider him who endured from sinners such hostility against himself, so that you may not grow weary or faint-hearted in your struggle against sin. You have not resisted to the point of shedding blood. For have you forgotten the exhortation that addresses you as sons? My son, do not regard lightly the discipline of the Lord. Do not be weary when reproved by him. For the Lord disciplines the one he loves and chastises every son whom he receives. It is for discipline that you have to endure. God is treating you as sons, for what son is there whom his father does not discipline? And if you, it's not in my notes, but scroll down to verse 11. I think it's important to read this. For the moment all discipline seems painful, rather than pleasant, but later it yields peaceful fruit of righteousness to those who have been trained by it. That's a verse to underline and remember. The feeling that what I'm going through at this moment is too much and it will never end is a pretty depressing place to be, isn't it? The feeling that where I am right now will never end, that I will never feel joy, that I will never experience gladness, that this period is never going to end, is a very depressing place to be. And that's what happens when we put our joy and our hope in the wrong place, is that we can't see past the moment. If it's a relationship and all of our joy is placed in this relationship, what happens when that relationship ends? If it's your job, what happens when that job ends? When our source of joy is gone, our joy goes with it. But we serve a God who will never leave and never forsake. And we place our joy in him. If our joy is in our children, they're going to fail. If your joy is in this church, we will fail you, right? If your joy is in your marriage, listen, who here was disappointed by their spouse before you even like changed out of your wedding clothes, right? Right? Like, before you even like put on a more comfortable dress, you're like, that schmuck let me down, right? But the Lord will never leave you or forsake you. Even when you're stuck in your sin, even when you're stuck in despair, even when you can't see the way forward, even when you don't. It's one of my favorite passages of Scripture. Lord, I believe, help my unbelief. Right? Even when we're stuck in unbelief, our God does not leave us or forsake us. We have a future because we trust in the one who holds the future. And our joy is found in that hope. And this is what makes joy possible, and it's what makes it accessible to us, is knowing the God who holds it all together. And not having to worry and think and fear and have this anxiety over what's going to happen or what's coming tomorrow. Because this same God who holds tomorrow has promised you joy. And we can hold to that promise. Now, there's also times that we feel God's discipline. Have you ever felt that? Right? That we feel discipline. And I'm not talking about, I feel punished for my sin. Like, that's not what I'm talking about. Like, there's consequences for sin, but I'm not talking about punishment for sin, because discipline, or punishment rather, is a very small piece of discipline. You know what I'm talking about? Like, we discipline our kids to put their clothes away. They do all right with that. We discipline our kids to brush their teeth. We discipline our kids to say please and thank you, right? These are disciplines that we build into their lives. They also get punished, but it's a really small piece of discipline, right? Right? And so when we come under, a lot of times, the expectations and the weights that God puts upon us, I want you to, like, we can admit there are times that following Christ is a heavy thing to do, right? That it's difficult, that it's a long road, it's a hard road, right? That many times following Jesus is difficult. But what we have is the promise of Christ that he will bear our burdens alongside of us. And so this weight that we carry doesn't have to be all on our shoulders, but we can walk with Christ and he carries our burdens with us. And not just that, he knows the burdens that we're under because he's been under them himself. Right? That we have a God who walked this world just like we will, or we do, and he knows the life that you're going to live because he's walked it himself. And one of the things he encouraged us right here was, you can endure under this, right? Have you ever got the feeling that I have endured as much as I can? I've taken as much as I can take. I can't do anymore. Have you ever felt that? And I would encourage you that you can. Because he said it right here, right? You have not endured to the point of shedding blood, saying, like, listen, you can take a little more. When I used to be a person that ran, which was a long time ago, I ran track, Mr. Masler was my track, or our cross-country coach. Anyone here know, what was it, Mike? Mike Masler, yeah. Fantastic human being. He was our track coach, or our cross country coach, and I ran cross country with him. And he would always say, "Your brain will quit." He would point with his whole hand. I don't know why, but like, your brain will quit before your body does, right? And he's right. Like, when your mind is telling you you can't take anymore, your body's like, "Eh, we can go a little farther," right? That your body can actually do a whole lot more than your brain will let it, right? And your spirit's kind of the same way. You can take a whole lot more. Your spirit can take a whole lot more weight than you realize it can. And you can endure a lot more than you realize. I think too many people give up and quit before the joy comes in the morning, right? That pain comes in the night, and they give up in the night instead of waiting for the morning when joy was coming, right? Instead of just enduring a little longer. Because you're not doing it alone. You're not enduring the pain of this life and the cares and the worries and the fears and the anxieties and your habits and all your sins and all the things that pile upon you. You're not enduring those things by yourself. God himself is walking with you through those things. And he is carrying that burden with you. And although it's true, there will be times that there will be weights put upon you that are too heavy for you to carry. The good news is, and the joy is found in the fact that God carries it for you. And you can lean on his arms. And if we had just held on a little longer, we'd have seen joy come in the morning. And it's just like raising up our kids, you know. I don't put burdens too heavy on my son to carry, right? That if there's times that he helps me around the house, and I if I'm carrying something heavy, I don't, like, moving, we're trying to make a brick wall, but the weather's not cooperating with that. We're trying to build this brick wall in our backyard for a fire pit. And I'll have Simon bring me bricks. I didn't ask him to carry me a bag of mortar that weighs more than he does, right? It's a burden too heavy for him. He helps me with it, which means he's under my feet as I try and carry it, right? But it's not a burden that I would put on him because it's too heavy of a burden, right? I carry it for him, right? I carry that, right? And God operates that exact same way. He will not put a burden on his child that he's not willing to also help you carry it, right? That's the truth of that. Our Father does not put a burden too heavy on us that he's not going to carry part of it for us. And many times he does discipline us, and that looks like the form of punishment. And sometimes he does because he loves you, right? And I tell our kids this. They're too young to understand it, but someday hopefully they do, that sometimes when I'm punishing them or I'm asking them to do something and they're getting upset, I'm like, listen, buddy, this is for your joy. I'm doing, like, you're getting a spanking right now. I know it sounds crazy, but you're getting a spanking right now for your joy, right? Like, I'm not enjoying it. This is for yours. Because if you go out and you get a job someday and you act like this with your boss, he's going to fire you. You won't be joyful then, right? You can't live this way in the world. I am trying to teach you something for your joy, right? So you can tell your kids that now. Like, next time you're spanking, I'm like, Pastor Tom said, this is for your joy. So smile, right? But no, it's the truth, right? That when we come under discipline, God is doing that for our joy. And it doesn't feel joyful in the moment, but he's doing that for future joy. Knowing that what he's seeking to create in us, although it's painful right now, what he's creating in us is something better. And that's evidence of the love of God. And it's in this relationship with God that we come under great joy, and we can experience the joy of this world through the relationship that we have with Jesus Christ. And this is something that Daniel did in his day, right? Daniel is exiled to Babylon as a young man, goes through the hardships of being there, sees himself multiple times called out for his faith. Daniel survives all of that, and actually he sees God promote him through those moments. I'm sure Daniel was not filled with joy when the edict came out that no one could pray to anyone but the Lord, right? But he endured and saw God prosper him. And so the book of Daniel chapter 2, I want to show you that real quick. And talk through a little bit about what happened in Daniel's day and what was going on with him. But Daniel chapter 2, verse 48 says this. Then King Nebuchadnezzar fell upon his face and paid homage to Daniel and commanded an offering and incense be offered up to him, which is crazy. Like, he treated Daniel as a god, right? And the king answered him and said to Daniel, truly your God is the God of gods, the Lord of kings. And this isn't, sorry, on the screen, but if you don't open your Bible, you just didn't get it. And a revealer of mysteries for you who have been able to reveal this mystery. And then the king gave Daniel high honors and many great gifts and made him the ruler over the whole province of Babylon and chief prefect over all the wise men of Babylon. And that's an important piece, that Daniel was the chief of the wise men, right? Because also from Daniel, we get a good number of our messianic prophecies. That Daniel laid out the groundwork that Jesus was coming, and Daniel was looking forward and seeing that, actually, if I'm not mistaken, the only Old Testament book that references Messiah, if I'm not mistaken, that uses that word. So Daniel, looking forward, seeing Christ coming, is now the chief, the leader, the teacher of all the wise men, and is teaching all the wise men that one day there's a coming Savior, and he's telling them what's going to happen, what events are going to lead up to that moment. Right? And then, these men are the only welcome party Jesus gets, besides shepherds who had to be told by an angel that he showed up. Right? We see wise men from the east, which is where Babylon is, come and worship Jesus. And they brought with them something interesting too. Gold, frankincense, and myrrh, right? Which if you read through Genesis, that the Garden of Eden had gold and aromatic resin, which is what frankincense and myrrh are. That God and his new Adam, Jesus Christ, brought the same gifts that the garden had. Isn't that amazing? And we see the Lord some 600 years before Jesus is going to step foot on earth, lay the groundwork for Jesus to be worshiped, right? Through a man like Daniel, who endured hardships for the joy that was to come, right? And you can see God at work in those moments. And actually, if you want to study something interesting, it just didn't really fit in with the theme of the sermon, and I just didn't really have the time to do it. But study what the star was, because it wasn't just a regular star, right? Like, regular stars don't lead people places, right? Regular stars don't rest over a house, right? You know what I'm talking about? These men knew what they were looking for, and when they saw it, they rejoiced. And our world, the world we live in, is looking for a Savior. And it finds its joy in other things, but it's not full joy. And it's pretty fleeting. The world is looking for Jesus. It just doesn't know it. And it's on us to show Jesus to the world. Matthew chapter 2, the ladies read it this morning, but I'll read it for us again. But when they saw the star, they rejoiced exceedingly with great joy. And going into the house, they saw the child with Mary his mother, and they fell down and worshipped him. And then opened their treasures, they offered him gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And they worshipped him. And I know this life will not always be joyful, but I want to encourage you to endure the pain for a moment, knowing that joy's coming in the morning. And I know sometimes life hurts. I know that things are hard. But hold that promise. And I think it's Psalm 20? Is that right? Psalm 20? Is that what I've written down? That joy is coming. We can take joy in the person of Christ. And this is why this command of joy is not a burden on us. That when he commands us to be joyful, it should lift our hearts, knowing that he will work to accomplish that in us. As we're going to stand and we're going to sing, I would encourage you to allow this message of having a joyful heart impress upon your worship. That as you sing and as you give thanks to God, I don't care if you can't sing, enough people are singing to drown it out. And plus, we have microphones, so we're going to be louder than you anyway. Well, depending. Some of you got pipes and you can be loud. But we're going to go ahead and sing and praise the Lord this morning. And I would encourage you to sing your praise to him this morning with a joyful heart. Would you stand with us as we sing?
to the world, the Savior reigns. Let all their songs implore. Wild fields and love, rocks, hills and lakes, repeat the sounding shore.
We enjoy doing here at Grace is the doxology, and it's just an opportunity for us to acknowledge together corporately where our blessings actually do come from. And I think it's good for our hearts to do that week after week. We don't want to do it because it's habit, but we want to do it with that reminder that every blessing I have in this life came from God alone. So Susan, would you lead us in that? Our Savior, we are blessed and thankful. We come before you this morning with thanksgiving, knowing that you are the giver of all good things. And even if that thing that you've given to us is pain or difficulty or a heavy burden, Lord, too heavy for us to carry, Lord, we look to that as a blessing from you, knowing that in that moment, I will be close by my Savior as he carries that burden alongside of me. I thank you, Jesus, so much for the strength that you give to us. And Lord, I thank you even more for our weakness so that we can see your strength on display. We love you, Christ, and thank you for all you do for us. In your name we pray. Amen. Have a seat real quick. Got a couple things just by way of announcement. Women's Guild Christmas party, 2 days? 2 days, yeah. So there you go. It's not for 2 days. It's in 2 days. But if you join, it's a party all year long. So, yeah, go ahead and join up. I am, there is not, I told some kids this, talking with Ella this morning about this. I am constantly very happy that I'm a man. So I just look from the outside looking in. Being a lady seems hard, right? And nothing on, like, against you ladies. It just seems like the world just stacks a lot of stuff on you. And like, childbirth alone is reason enough for me to be like, I think I'll just be happy where I'm at. But if this is one of the moments I'm sad I'm not a lady because I can't join. That's just being honest. It's an awesome ministry, and you'll be sad if you're not a part of it. And so come out the 14th, just see what they're about. Now the next one is we have met the match, the 20,000 for Daniel, and actually exceeded that by a few thousand. So we've seen God bless and move. At this moment, I talked to Daniel on Friday, or Thursday, he is at $147,000 of his $150,000 goal. So praise God for that. He is just about there, and we have a couple more fundraisers. We may just see him there by the end of the year through the work that we're doing here at Grace. So just heartfelt from Daniel, thank you. We have literally watched as a little country church hit a third of that chunk. And that's just God moving in the generosity of your hearts. So literally $3,000 will have him where he needs to be to start rescuing kids out of sex trafficking and slavery and organ harvesting and all the evils that are happening there. So one, hit that up in your prayers, but also praise God for what's already been done. Now, next week is the last week for council nominations, and I need to get names in quick. So that means if you've been here for a year, right? I think you've had to have been here at the church for a year and be considered an active member here at Grace. And of course, there's other qualifications as well. Let's be in prayer about who to nominate and draw those names in by next week. Our Christmas Eve service at 7 p.m., that is on Christmas Eve, so surprise. And we have a great time. You will not want to miss our Christmas Eve candlelight service. It is highlight of the year, in my opinion. So, all right, what's next? Anything else? Okay, well, we'll announce that later. The vote's on the 26th. Tonight is our youth Christmas party at my house. So come to my house. If the driveway's full, park at the church, walk over. You know, just come to my house. Parents, you're welcome to hang out. You're welcome to stay there if you want. We'd love to have you. Bring a snack of some kind with you. We're providing drinks and some cookies to decorate for one of our competitions. But be there 6 to 8 tonight at my house. And that's for our group here. And then if you guys want to cut the live feed, Phoenix, cut the live feed for me. We have a little bit of family business to take care of. Actually, really exciting family business. Usually when I say cut the live feed, it means we got work to do and it's not going to be comfortable. But this is an exciting one because we have been praying about this and we've been considering this. And we have decided that it would be wise for our church moving forward to hire an associate pastor in some kind of a part-time capacity. And the Lord just kind of settled our hearts on Tim Shimmons. And Tim is a fantastic human being. If you know him, we love him dearly. And Tim's going to do some part-time work for us here at the church at the salary.